Bethel World Outreach Church. Reaching a city to touch the world.
Go to Galatians 6, verses 7 through 11 is where we'll start. Let's just read this and then I'll jump into our points. When you have it, say amen, and then I'm going to say ready, and we'll read together with some power. Ready. You have it? Say amen. Ready. Read. Thank you very much. May God add a blessing to the reading and hearing of his word. If I was going to give you three words to anchor you in the text today, to anchor you in the points that I'm going to talk about, it's the three words are this. There's God time. And God time is unchanging. It's always there. It was there before you. God time is his way of doing things and being right. God time is his way of doing things and being right, and it's independent of your emotion, it's independent of your feeling. It doesn't matter whether you agree to it, ascribe to it. God's way of doing things and being right exists whether or not you can take advantage of it. The second thing is seed time. Remember, the scripture says that as long as the earth remains, there'll be night and day, cold and heat, summer, winter, seed time. Earth is still here. There'll always be seed time. And seed time is something you must take advantage of. It does you no good to just know and understand that there is a principle. You must actually do something with the seed you have. If you do nothing with it, you only have information. You don't have a principle that you can really act on. You must take advantage of it. You have to do something. And finally, there's harvest time. And if you take advantage of seed time, harvest time is unavoidable. It's unavoidable. God's time is his way of doing things and being right in the earth. Seed time is something you must take advantage of because he's always giving you seed. I'll prove that in a second. And finally, if you're participating in seed time, it's inevitable to get harvest. Whether your harvest is good or evil, the proof of your harvest is in what you sowed. If you've sown something egregious, you'll reap something horrific. It's unavoidable, doesn't change, unmovable. These are the principles that we have today. I want to tell you a story that one of the members of this church sent to me that I thought was really great, could help all of us. And it's about the Far East, it's about China, it's about bamboo. It takes 5 years to grow bamboo. Needs to be watered, needs to be fertilized daily. And it doesn't grow until the fifth year. But once it does, it breaks through the ground within 5 weeks and is about 90 foot tall. Now, there is the understanding, therefore, that when you sow the bamboo seed, there is some nurturing and care for that which you put in the ground that you need to take. And if you're patient and don't go and dig up the bamboo and pull it out and say, it is not doing much. Because that particular seed is the design to come up after the fifth year. And when it comes up strong. And you can make the mistake of looking at someone else's harvest and trying to figure out why you're doing some of the same things and you're not getting anything that sprouts up quickly. And it's simply because the process goes like this. This is God time. The Bible says the sower, this is Mark 4, says the sower goes out and he sows the seed. The seed begins to grow. No. The Bible said he sows the seed, then he goes home and goes to sleep. The seed begins to grow. He don't know how. Night and day. Then the seed first gives him a sign. Then the blade, then the ear, then the full corn in the ear. Then immediately he puts it to sickle, for the harvest has come. Many times we don't believe in the law of reciprocity, which is simply sowing and reaping. Simply because when we sow, we don't see something immediately happen. But God is helping us understand in this text that be not deceived. It's the first thing, that the lack of growth can deceive you into believing that God time doesn't work. God is not mocked that God doesn't even care. Or there's a way to bypass God's process. There's sowing and reaping. This is a principle. This is a law, just like gravity and everything else that we have. This works all the time. So let's just deal with the first part of this, the be not deceived. The earlier verses, I love how, I'm going to try to stick close to my notes so you get every nugget, okay? See, and you almost missed one because I looked down at my notes and I said, see, I'm going to skip over that and I'm not going to do it today. Not today, maybe tomorrow. I wrote a little note down here. What good is a seed you don't use? Seed unused profits you nothing. And then what good is understanding the sowing process if you're not in possession of seed? So what has God put in your hands? I love the 11th verse of the entire Bible shows you how much that God is committed to making sure you and I have the main ingredient to getting the law at work. It's first him, and second, you need seed. It says in 11, says God said, let the earth sprout vegetation, plants yielding seed, fruit trees bearing fruit which have their seed, each according to his kind on the earth. So basic a scripture, so basic a principle, that from the day we got to this planet, God was giving us seed for everything we liked or desired or needed. And it comes in the form of something you can eat and something you can sow. And this is how 2 Corinthians 9, verse 10 says it in the New Testament. And this is the Amplified version, so you can really get this principle. It says, now he who provides seed for the sower also gives bread for food. He will provide and multiply your seed for sowing, that is your resource, and increase the harvest of your righteousness, which shows itself in active goodness, kindness, and love. Another way of saying this is God is saying, whenever he gives you something to eat, he also gives you something to sow. So whenever you like something, it is never for your full consumption. Okay, I'm going to say it again. Whenever you like something, it's never for your full consumption. You don't need to fully consume it. You need to understand some of this is for me to eat and some of this is for me to sow. And if you're only a consumer, you will find yourself in lack faster. Then he goes on to say, no, I'm talking about active goodness. I'm talking about love and right. In other words, God gives you more than something that is physical to sow. He gives you these qualities that you can sow. And when you understand these qualities of love and kindness and goodness, and you can begin to sow this and reap this. I hear this all the time from myself. I've sown, but I didn't reap. I've given kindness, but I've reaped something else. You see, there are times when we think we sowed a good seed, but in actuality, you sowed seeds of discontent. You sowed seeds of malice. And what happens to us is we've lost the ability to be objective about what is coming at us in life. Everything has become a demonic attack or a testing of the Lord instead of a seed we've sown and a harvest we've reaped. Challenge you today that if you don't like the life that you have, if you feel that it has some misery, just take some inventory and what you sow out of your mouth. What do you sow in your activities? I just take a small inventory if you're sick of getting frustration and irritation and you're always in that discontent mode. What do you sow? Do you sow complaint? I can preach to myself because I can complain about a plethora of things. I am the number one complainer who comes in this building daily. I get here early enough to complain about stuff by myself. Why is that like that? When are you going to get that? None of which I want someone to do to me. But it's easy for me to do it to others. And I'm shocked when someone wants to bring up something about my character. I believe I'm unimpeachable. You know, the Bible says a man's way is just in his own eyes. You always gonna look good to yourself. But you get into the first scripture of deceived. Some of y'all woke up this morning and said, I look good, but you needed to ask somebody besides the mirror. Now, I just let that alone. I'm gonna leave that alone right now. You know who you are. Maybe you don't know who you are. Just ask a friend, how do I look today? Faithful are the wounds of a friend. They'll tell you the truth. Deception is defined as something that causes you to wander from the truth, to believe something that is not true, to give a mistaken impression. The Bible says in 1 Timothy 2:14 that Adam was not the one deceived. It was the woman who was deceived and became a sinner. What is the end result of deception? You become a sinner. You miss the mark. Some of us are willfully deceived. I'm gonna give you some little basic play examples to help you understand. I actually willfully deceived myself that I could play in the NFL right now. I just look at their size. I look at my size. I say, well, I'm strong. When them Vanderbilt boys came, I was so delusional. No, it's true. This is a true story. This is how this can happen to you even in church. Before I knew it, I had walked up to some of the big boys and looked up. Hey, I could take you right now with my suit on. And I felt like they just kind of patted me on the head. It's all right, little man. It's okay. You know, when you're deceived and you actually buy your own lie, when you actually believe that if you eat of a tree, you'll be just like God, it's a dangerous thing. Before somebody else can do the work of deceiving you, you've done it to yourself. 1 John 4, 1 says it this way, "Beloved, do not believe every spirit, but test the spirits to see whether they are from God. Many false prophets are going into the world, but by this you know the spirit of God. Every spirit that confesses that Jesus Christ has come in the flesh is from God." Every spirit that's going all right with Jesus, you're all right. You won't be deceived. And every spirit that does not confess that Jesus is not from God, this spirit is Antichrist, which you have heard has come and is now in the world already. You see, that self-deception is you, that you won't test stuff. You're gullible. You believe every little wind, I don't know what they think about me. Well, did they say something to you? Did they literally say they didn't like you? Then they probably all right with you. Well, because I know how people look. Let that go. Let it go. Sorry, I have feelings, premonitions. I know stuff. Test the spirit. You paranoid. Matthew 24 says, people can deceive you. This is what Jesus said. Not only can you deceive yourself, people can deceive you. The Bible says in Matthew 24, 4, 5, 11, and 24, Jesus answered and said unto them, take heed that no man deceives you. For many shall come in my name, saying, I am the Christ, and they shall deceive many. Many false prophets shall rise, and they shall deceive many. And there shall arise false Christs and false prophets, and they shall show great signs and wonders. If it were possible, they would deceive my very elect. What do you know about deception when it comes to you as believers? God says you are not deceived. Your inheritance is not deception. The world will deceive you. Colossians 2:8 says, see that no one takes you captive by philosophy. An empty deceit, according to human traditions, according to the elemental spirits of the world, and not according to Christ. See, this political season, so everybody got to go vote, and somebody's promoting some form of something that they feel. And what is your discernment? To discern whether or not this is from men, their traditions, their philosophies, or whether or not this is from God. Your allegiance is not to men. Your allegiance is not to the Democratic Party. Your allegiance is not to the Republican Party, nor to the independents, nor to your favorite governor to be elected, or you just like their personality. None of that. You can't be deceived. You are singularly making your decisions as moved by God the Holy Spirit based on conviction. Well, Pastor James, these people said they was moved and I was moved and we was moved in two different directions. Look, I can't figure it all out. All I can tell you is when you go in there, vote as he leads you, because he's dealing with you. He already controls the world. He's trying to do things to build you up. And so you can't think that the answer is in your hands as much as it's in God's hands. And I don't want you to deceive yourself. There's demonic deception. But I'm going to tell you something about the demonic deception. The devil, the Bible says, he was so confused himself that if he would have known what God was doing, he would have never crucified the Lord of glory. That didn't tell you how messed up he is. The Bible said people who deceive, they deceive themselves and they go on deceiving everybody else. You know what that's called? That time when you get a lie and you forgot it was a lie, you told it. You told the lie. You knew it was a lie. You know, because we in church. I'm not coming to pick out your lie. But you knew when you said it, it was a strong exaggeration. Maybe a little manipulation. Had some lie in there. Now, when you told it, you did all you could to justify, but now you even forgot what was the lie and what was the truth. Now you don't even try. Now you retell the story as if it's factual. It used to be, I think what happened was, I'm going to tell you what happened. I know it for sure. It's okay. God is not mocked. Being mocked is to turn up your nose, to sneer at something, to tease, to laugh, to scorn, to be contemptuous. In other words, there are times when we just don't like God's process. And we just say, I don't get into that part. I don't want to do it that way. We can actually know he says something simple like love your enemies or bless them that curse you or do good to them that despitefully use you and persecute you that you might be children of God. But you find I find justifiable reasons why you can know these truths and walk over them. There is no justification for treating someone poorly. Well, I'm just mad today. Just deal with it. Told my wife that one time I just came in. I'm all bound up. So you know, everybody just don't need to bother me today. She said, well, that's not in the word. You can't even be free in your own house. Yeah. 2 Corinthians 5:10 says there's a day coming where we all must stand before the judgment seat of Christ so that each of us can receive what is due for the things we have done in the body, whether they're good and evil. See, he's not mocked. It doesn't matter. As a believer, one day you and I will stand before him and we'll give an account for every idle word, the motive behind what you did. Because I don't know about you, sometimes I do what's right to get my way. I don't do it because I love God. Now, you may love him more than me. Sometimes I do what's right because it gives me power to get what I want in the end. It's not motivated out of love. See, he's going to be coming after all of that. Revelations 20 and 11 says this way. He's like, maybe you're in here and you're not a believer in Jesus Christ. That's okay. He's still going to deal with you too. Bible says he saw it was a great white throne judgment seated on it, and he was seated on it. The earth and the heaven fled from his presence, and there was no place for them. That sounds scary. And I saw the dead, great and small, standing before the throne, and the books were opened, and another book was opened, which is the book of life. The dead were judged according to what they had done as recorded in those books. The sea gave up its dead that were in it. Death and Hades gave up the dead that were in them. And each person was judged according to what they had done. And death and Hades were thrown into the lake of fire, and the lake of fire is the second death. And anyone's name who was not written in the book of life was thrown into the lake of fire. Now, that's the kind of scriptures they don't just read in church no more. They just scared. I'm reading it scared now. Like, man, Lord, is my life right with you right now? I just want to say, I don't want to go to glory quick, you know. I just want to say, hey, me and you are all right, right? Look, it doesn't matter. He's not mocked. You may not want to participate in his process, His little seed time, harvest time. But if you sow the wrong thing, you'll reap the wrong harvest. My grandmother used to say, because I was a little, what they used to say back in the day was, he's mannish. Man, that's a bad little boy. And my grandmama used to say, my mama used to say, baby, you're going to keep this up, and one day life's going to slap you in the face. That's what she said. I'm not going to spank you no more because spankings don't do nothing. But one day life going to slap you in the face. And one day they was all, you know, I guess my grandmother was going to have a party and it's going to be a sleepover and everything. And everybody was getting ready to go. And she said, and I heard my grandmama say, but you know how they didn't think I could hear it. Say, now everybody else can stay, but he can't stay. Because you know how he'll be. He done tore this party up. We don't know what's going to go on. You got to take him home with you. So I walked. I said, Grandma. I said, Mom, did Grandma this? She said, baby, life has just slapped you in the face. You've been slapped down. Let's keep going in the Bible. Seed time. So whoever sows pleases his flesh, for from the flesh he'll reap corruption or destruction. Whoever sows to please the Spirit shall the Spirit reap life. Do you know you can actually miss, Pastor Bruce, you can actually miss your sowing season? You know, you can miss the right moment to deliver the right thing. Let me make it real practical. I mean, this is like practical. Like if you try to sow some corn seed in the winter, that's like, that ain't gonna go good for you. You need to do like April to June. So you got no harvest you can spread. You got seed and you're trying to sow it, but you missed your season. There's times in relationships where you should just say, you know what? I'm sorry. It was my fault. But because you hold on, you wait years and years and years. You're never wrong. You're never wrong. So guess what? Now, when they say, I accept your apology, but I don't want to be in relationship with you anymore. You know what? You can miss your sowing season. And you can't accuse God. He told me it was seed time harvest. Now I'm coming to tell you I love you. And you're going to reject my love? No, they can't receive it. The ground is too hard now. You're not going to like the scripture I'm about to read because, you know, it's tough. Galatians 5, 18 through 26. I'm going to read these verses because he's going to show you what the fruit of the flesh looks like and what the fruit of the Spirit looks like. If you're sowing to the flesh, here's your proof text. Here's how you can tell where you're sowing. If you're sowing to the Spirit, here's how you can tell. The acts of the flesh are obvious, or the fruit of the flesh is obvious. Sexual immorality, impurity, debauchery, idolatry and witchcraft, hatred, discord, jealousy, fits of rage, selfish ambition, dissensions, factions, and envy, drunkenness, orgies, and the like. I warn you, and as I did before, that those who live like this will not inherit the kingdom of God. Remember, God time is his way of doing things and being right. If you do all this, if this is the fruit, you will not inherit God time. You won't get it. Said, but the fruit of the Spirit, if you want to give yourself a checklist, don't stay. If you found yourself in that list, I feel the tension of it, feel the heat of it, feel the problem with it, but don't get stuck there. Look at what you can have. The fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, forbearance, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. Against such things there is no law. The Bible says, when you sow, Ecclesiastes 11 says, cast your bread upon many waters, for you know what will prosper, whether this or that. Sow your seed eight places. He said, he that regards the wind will not sow. I'm sorry, I lost my plate. I had a free soul spirit on me. He said, in the morning sow your seed. In the evening withhold it not from your hand. And for you do not know what will prosper, whether this or that. In other words, if you look for favorable conditions to determine whether or not you can sow, if you observe the wind, you're not going to sow. If all you do is doom and gloom, say, get up in the morning with a perspective, I'm going to sow. There's something you can sow daily. It's a power in the seed. It's a power in the seed when you sow. How you sow, the Bible said, when you sow, sow bountifully. Sow, don't sow sparingly. Sow cheerfully. It says, what should you sow? Mark 4, 14 says, the sower sow, I mean, this is King James, because, you know, I get to pull out King James every now and then. King James. The sower soweth the word. And what is that fifth? Pastor Corey, what is that fifth on the end? What is that? The soweth part? No, it means with continuous effect. In other words, this is something that you, this is present. Present active indicative. Boom. Sorry, I asked the wrong theologian. Sorry. Sorry, Pastor Bruce. I'm so sorry. I just caught you off guard. Next time, it's you. this is a right now thing, active. You do this all the time. Why do you sow? Because the Bible says it's more blessed to give in Acts 20 than receive. Let us not become weary in doing good. This is harvest time now. Let us not become weary in doing good. Don't get weary. This is to lose heart. The connotation here is a pregnant woman in labor. And think about the midwives and everybody around her saying, I cannot birth a baby. I've been there for the process. And I can tell you this, that woman needs encouragement not to lose heart. Because those looking around, when you see the pain, when you see all that's going on, you want to lose heart. And you've got to be encouraging. Don't lose heart. Don't become weary. At the proper time, you'll reap a harvest if you do not give up. I know it's a great temptation out there to give up on your life. Because you don't like what you've been getting out of life. Could be because you've not understood fully enough a principle that could break you free. I love how Mark 4, 24 says, consider carefully what you hear. He continued, for with the measure you use it, it'll be measured back to you even more. Whoever has will be given more, and whoever does not have, even what they have will be taken from them. You see, you are to just keep on sowing so you can keep on reaping. And if you give a lot, you'll get a lot back. I know this world feels loveless and contemptuous and just hard. But you know what? You can hug the life into death. No, you really can make a difference. You are the seeds within a community to bring a harvest of righteousness. You are the difference makers. When you see that contempt at the polls tomorrow, if you haven't voted already, you bring your smile. You bring, it's all right. If you're a Republican and you stand next to Democrats, you say, hey, it's all right. You know, we love y'all. Just throw it out there. Vice versa. Doesn't matter. You're the difference maker because your assignment is greater. It says that God says, Son of Man is coming back in his glory and he will reward each person according to what he's done. God is going to reward you for everything you've done. The Bible says in Genesis 26, where we, the book of first things, we learn that, I love this, that Isaac sowed in the land and he reaped in that same year a hundredfold blessing. Final scripture I'll give you about the breakthrough. Maybe that was a lie. So the almost final scripture I'll give you. It's in Matthew 7:17 says, likewise, every good tree bears good fruit, and every bad tree bears bad fruit. A good tree cannot bear bad fruit. It cannot. Well, I did everything right. Well, maybe we need to double check that. And a bad tree cannot bear good fruit. I know they do all the wrong thing, but I think they good deep down inside. Get away from them. If you the person that always likes the bad guy, he stays bad. Just get away. You can't change him. You're not going to change the bad guy. Every tree that does not bear good fruit is to be cut down and thrown into the fire. What will you throw away today? What's fruitless in your life? God's asking you to cut it down. Thus, their fruit, by their fruit, you recognize them. I'll conclude. You can stand to your feet. You know, ministry team, you can come down. God time is real. He has a way of doing things and being right, and it's the law of reciprocity, sowing and reaping. You're not going to get out of it. Seed time is every day. Get up in the morning and sow your seed, but you're sowing something more than something physical. You're sowing the goodness of the Lord. Harvest is always coming. Do you like the harvest you currently have? Because it tells you a story. It tells you a story about perhaps how you live. Yes, there are anomalies. Yes, there are God factors where he's allowed certain items in your life. But if you get just real honest with yourself, are you living out a life that's based on the seeds you sow? If you don't like the harvest, you need to cut something off. Cut it off. Stop thinking you can change things by how mad you get. Has it worked? Has it worked to tell your most significant person how mad you were or whatever? It doesn't work. Sow a different seed, then reap a different harvest. Today, when God gave me this message, he helped me realize that he didn't just give a principle, he lives a principle. The Bible says, except a grain of wheat fall to the ground and die, it abides alone. But if it die, it becomes a tree, a life. That's what Jesus did. The Word made flesh, came, died. And now, because he was raised to newness of life, he can offer something to you. You know, in this moment, I knew there would be a lot of people in the room who perceived they didn't like the harvest that they were getting. And my altar moment is for you today. If you hadn't liked the harvest that you've been receiving, and you actually want Jesus to get some crop failure going in your life, you can't figure out how to do it on your own. You need that miraculous breakthrough to God. Just come down and chop out all those weeds. Get everything out supernaturally. I was believing God for a supernatural cutting down of a bad harvest, and that Jesus could be the foundation of a good one in your life. He sowed his life that you might have it and have it to the full. And I don't know what you need today, a friend, a breakthrough, salvation, deliverance, whatever it is. I just want to give a minute before we get dismissed from the service that if you have any prayer needs whatsoever, that you would push back shame, push past guilt, push past pride, push past yourself. Don't be deceived. If you're not in the right place with Jesus, and that means you got deliverance, you got whole and sound, then come get a breakthrough.
If you've watched this message and you want to make Jesus Lord of your life, I've got good news. You can do it right now. I want you to pray with me. Say, Lord Jesus, come into my life for the rest of my life. I acknowledge I am a sinner. I need you, my Savior. I believe you died for me. I believe you were raised from the dead on the third day. And I confess that you are now Lord of my life. If you've just prayed that prayer, I have good news for you. You have eternal life. The next step for you is to get in a Bible-believing church. We volunteer to be that church. But if not us, we pray God's blessings on you as you search for God's best for you. Thank you.